Paul Wall was no overnight celebrity. He laid the groundwork for years in Houston before becoming a nationally known artist. He was once upon a time a street team king and a promotion guy throughout the city of Houston, passing out flyers, hanging up posters, and giving DJs vinyl records and CDs to play music from local labels as well as national labels like No Limit and Cash Money. Networking this way made Paul a fixture in the local scene, and everybody knew who he was. In chapter two, we talk about this time of his life.
You did really cool stuff that I would aspire to want to do. Like, you did street team for a lot of different labels, right? Yeah. How did you get into that?
I just loved being a part of any of it, you know? So to me, being an actual rapper was like about as realistic as me saying, I want to go to the NBA. I want to be president one day. Like, it's like, you know, it's possible, but what is the reality? Like, one in 20 million, you know, like, what is the actual odds that I could be a professional rapper? And then my mom always instilled in me a sense of reality. Is this what you want to do? Okay, well, you got bills. So are you getting paid from this to be able to pay your bills, to support, you know, your career? Is this a real career or is it a hobby? It's fine if it's a hobby, but you have to have means to pay your bills, to take care of everything. So I always had multiple hustles to kind of fund my hobby of being in the hip hop. My dream was to be a DJ. You know, to, like I say, to be an artist was not even an option. My options were to be a DJ, to do street promotions, and that was it. If I wanted to be in the hip hop industry as a professional. And to me, that was my option. So as a youngster, I could get on, you know, nobody's going to say, oh yeah, you want to DJ my club? I never met you before. You want to come DJ my club? No one's going to let you do that. But they will say, hey, you want to pass out some flyers? Yeah, you pass out some flyers. So that's what I would do. I would pass out my flyers. And, you know, I would be 14, 15 years old. So I'm too young to get in the club anyway. So I would, you know, I didn't care, you know, that I wasn't allowed in the club. I would just hang out in the parking lot anyway. That was good enough for me. And I'd pass out flyers, put them on cars, you know, put them on doorsteps, indoors. I'd hand them to people. I'd learn various techniques, you know, of not just giving something to somebody. You give it to them and say what you're giving them to them, because then they get the double effect of what they're looking at and holding in what they're hearing, you know. And when they walk to their car, they're going to see a flyer on their car too. So I really took my promotion serious. And, you know, I just kind of like parlayed that into promoting myself and, you know, whatever music I was making. But even then, it went from flyers to, you know, working with my boy Ace and 5-4 over at, they were doing Def Jam, and 5-4 was doing No Limit with me and Green, and they would just let me work with them. You know, every now and then I would get paid, but it was more like an internship, you know what I'm saying, just trying to come up, earn my keep. But then eventually I was getting paid, and I was the man handling the accounts. And I would not only be passing out flyers, I'd be bringing the DJs the vinyl, you know, I'd be, what, you know, doing all kind of putting up posters inside the club. So it got to be pretty easy for me to get in the club when I was 14, 15, because I'd be there. If the club opens, you know, the doors open at 10, I'd be there at 9. And, you know, I'd know the security at the door. I'd know the bartenders. I'd know the DJ. And I'd say, hey, what's up? I'm here. I brought y'all some new, these are new albums that came out this week. Can I put up some flyers in the bathrooms? Can I, you know, put some posters up in the DJ? Well, yeah, come on in. They let me come in, and I just would stay there till, you know, the club really opened. And then, you know, I'd hang out in the DJ booth with my boy Wicked Cricket. He was the DJ that, you know, he'd shot me out and everything. And it'd be like, damn, I'm, you know, I'm way too young to be in the club, and I'm getting shout outs. Man, it was, you know, so that was cool for me. You know what I'm saying? It was no complaints at all on my end. And then, eventually that led me to meeting all the DJs. And I, you know, then doing the promotions for the record labels. You know, my boy Lump, he was doing the Cash Money account. And like I said, Cash Money was somebody I was a big fan of, I always wanted to work their account because I felt a sense of pride. I believed in the artist. I wanted to see the artist win. I want to put other people onto this artist. You don't know about this person? Let me tell you about this person. They got a new album coming out. They new song. Oh, they went off on there. They got this production. Like, I really took my promotion serious because I believed in the accounts I was, you know, promoting. So when I got access to all the vinyl, that allowed me to be a DJ, because you couldn't go buy vinyl in those days. The only way to get a vinyl for a song was you would know somebody from the record label, or there'd be people that'd be like people that would press up a vinyl, like a white label vinyl, and it'd have, you know, the five or six songs that you couldn't find anywhere on vinyl. They would have a vinyl with all of them on it, and they'd sell them for like $20 or something. But that'd be the only way you could get the vinyl or the new music. It was to do yeah. promotions.
And I bet you had all the good posters. You probably had every good, like you were like hanging your posters for like Mean Green Major Players album. Like
definitely.
Wow.
Yeah. I still got a lot of that memorabilia too, man. I just kept, you know, that I believed in. But even in working those days as a doing promotion, like I say, to open a lot of doors for DJs. And then I, you know, when it came to me being a rapper, I already garnished a little bit of respect here and there from other DJs who are like key figures in the Houston community. So they gave me a shot. So Michael Watts, I was doing promotions for the Swisher House before I was rapping, which me and T. Ferris, who manages, you know, the world famous Megan Thee Stallion, he was managing me. He managed, you know, Mike Jones, Lil Kiki, Zero. He definitely did a lot of management for some, you know, great artists, you know, from Texas, from Houston. But
yeah, I was gonna ask you about T. Ferris, because that's the first time I ever heard his name was that you said it. So I'm like, okay, this guy must be a major player in the Houston scene.
Me and him came up together, you know, we were 16, 17, passing out flyers, you know, pressing up the mixtapes and CDs, actually delivering the mixtape CDs to different stores around the state. So then I got to see that side of it too, the retail side. So I'd go to the different stores. I'd go one direction, T. Ferris would go the other direction. And, you know, he might go I-10 East, I might go I-10 West. You know, I might go 45 North, he's going 45 South.
Wow.
And, you know, it helped me, you know, gain an understanding of the music business, the music industry. And Michael Watts would always, you know, tell me, hey, man, shit, this is a way to turn your hobby into a hustle. Your hobby is being an artist. You like doing rap music. You're talented at it as any of this, DJ, any of this. Well, this is how you could turn it into a hustle and turn it into a job and career. But T. Ferris was somebody who, you know, we didn't really have managers back then, you know, and we the same age. And he definitely, you know, he's somebody I had to beg him to be my manager, because he was like, man, he didn't want to, you know, he didn't want to mess up my career. He'd tell me that, man, I don't know what to do to be a manager. I'm going to mess up your career. I don't want to mess up your career. You know, there's a lot of responsibility you're giving me. But I didn't, all I cared was he was somebody I trusted. He's somebody I believe that he believed in me and I believe in him. And we'll figure it out. We didn't go to school for this, but we're hustlers. We're great at adjusting, making adjustments. So we'll find a way to, you know, make it work. We definitely can make it work. And we made it work.
I would say so. So would you say that like earned your respect as like a white guy trying to come up in the scene? I don't know if there was a lot of white people around in the scene then, if you were like basically the only guy out there running around doing it, and then they just accepted you as their own kind of thing, or was it difficult trying to come up through the ranks?
I think it was difficult just period, but I personally didn't see any difficult like being a white, like it wasn't harder or anything being a white artist, at least for me. But there were other artists too. There was my boy Toe Down, he was doing it. There were a few other white artists in Texas or Louisiana, you know, this kind of area that, you know, were trying to come up or had a career at that time. But I think a lot of people, man, they assumed I was either mixed or Mexican or a Frenchman or from Louisiana, you know, because people would always get that. I had a big fan base in Southern Louisiana, and they would always claim me as being a Frenchman, Creole. You know, I had a bunch of friends who were Mexican, fans who were Mexican. They would always claim me as being Mexican. Even if they knew I wasn't, they didn't care. They still claimed, nah, you and us. You know, all my friends who were light-skinned, they would claim me as being light-skinned. And I'm just there just being me, you know. But I think a lot of people did. They assumed I was something other than white. But it was something, too, that, you know, I don't wear it on my sleeve everywhere. Like it's you know, I being a rapper that's white, I've met a lot of white rappers, and you know, my path isn't always the same as their path. You know, so some rappers that are white, you know, that's all they are.